In this video I'm going to use a 3D printer to make an analog camera. This camera is going to be a little unusual because I'm combining two different types of photographic cameras. The first is a slit-scan camera, which is a type of photographic method designed to remove the time distortion created by the shutter, for example, for use on the finishing line of races. And the second is a disc camera, a marketing gimmick as far as I can tell. The slit-scan stuff is something I've worked on with the BBKP guys, who I collaborate with on art exhibitions. We did a photography exhibition back in 2013. Since then, pretty much every year, we have done some kind of photography-based educational workshop at a museum or art gallery. Disc cameras were brought to my attention a few weeks ago by Nathan, who I share the studio with, and who also has his own YouTube channel called OpenTronic, who bought back a disc camera from a car boot sale. It's quite an unusual camera, produced in the 80s and aimed at the consumer market. As a format, they were a massive flop, and for obvious reasons. Each disc could only produce 15 photos on a hard-to-process negative, while the standard 36 exposure film spool gave you more photos, but could also be automatically processed. The choice was simple. I can only imagine some bright spark somewhere thought by putting an analog photographic method onto a disc, this would in some way reinvigorate photography and make it feel more futuristic. The cameras look like a stack of floppy disks, and they're really no more advanced than an 18th century automaton, mechanically speaking. That said, the ambition to remake photography more interesting is not a bad one, and I happen to like the unusual disc-shaped negatives produced. They remind me of the wide images peering into the Large Hadron Collider, or the gigantic rotating sets used in the making of Stanley Kubrick's Space Odyssey. What I'm hoping to do is to produce a slit scan on a disc, which will render the time distortion properties of the traditional slit scan obsolete, because the disc will be moving quicker, closer to the circumference. But firstly, I need to design the camera, which I'll be doing on Fusion 360, and then printing the individual parts out on my Anycubic i3 Mega. I've already started designing some parts for this camera, and I've produced a few different versions. This was the first one that I produced, and it's a little large and it took a little while to print out, and it's a direct drive, so this handle here is connected eventually by a screw to the disc, which will have the paper stuck to it. And if I make that disc invisible, you can see this section here, if I zoom in, is where the slit will go, and it will be made by simply cutting a disc of paper along the center and sticking it on either side with the slit going from the top to the bottom. If I remove the lens cap, you can see a window here which will house the lens that I'll be using from some reading glasses. The problem I have with this camera and this method, the direct drive method, is that I need to turn the disc very slowly to expose the photographic paper that I'll be using. Obviously, if I was using a negative, then I would be able to move the disc by hand and still produce images, because negatives are generally a lot more sensitive than photographic paper. What I'm going to show you is the assembly of the first camera and some of the mistakes I've made, and then move on to the alterations I decided to incorporate into the design.
In theory, I could have set up the other printers to print as well, but this one just works so well. I'm a bit reluctant to kind of fool around with the other two. Okay, just pulled that off. Looks pretty good. A little bit of a flex to it. I mean, it's still warm, so I should leave it in something flat. You should really leave these on the machine as they cool down. I always seem to like get a bit too excited. It looks like a little disc sander, doesn't it? Okay, so this is the lid. I'm currently printing the box section that will fit on this, although I kind of pulled this off the printer a bit too quickly and it's got a little bit of a bend to it. Added this lip around here to try and help keep this flat. I should have added some across as well, as you would with sort of injection molded pieces. Maybe I even needed something on the back of this. Essentially this fits through here, but they're practically flush now along the top. So I don't think I really needed this ring, but I think I might try and just glue it on anyway, so all the parts are where they were, I expected them to be.
I made a few mistakes with clearance for what should have been interlocking pieces with the first model. Because of the compression of the first layer, which is needed to adhere the PLA to the heat bed, a groove on the turning handle and lid were a lot narrower than the bits which were meant to fit into them.
Just leave that to set for a little while, and then I'll glue this section onto the handle, or if I can, maybe I'll find a machine screw that will actually tighten in there, or throw some glue in there, I'm not sure yet. Just swap the machine screw out to get a better purchase. And now it works, it's a bit tight. Would have been nice if I could have had a little bit of a gap there, maybe avoided that noise. But everything's doing what it's meant to be doing. Okay, the other thing I need to do is attach a lens, in this case from a pair of reading glasses, onto what will be my focusing lens. I have to admit that noise is really annoying. I haven't created a mechanism for locking this section onto here at different focal lengths, so what I think I can do is put a bit of tracing paper in the camera, or where the disc will actually lay inside the box, and just visually look at what focuses, and really all I want to know is, you know, where the infinity is. Okay, I'm gonna have to use three lenses, so one will end up going on the outside. Possibly another back on the inside if I can manage it. I'll just show you. So you're looking at this section here.
What I'm finding is the shorter the lens housing, the more reading glasses lenses I need to stack up.
Well, I just wonder, like, where is it more convenient for you as well?
Well, I guess in that corner, it probably, you know, in the middle of the room. That's Nathan's camera.
Yeah. This is Nathan being squashed by a camera.
I also designed a square hole in the camera body, which I was planning to attach the slit to, but it would have been several millimetres above the disc and photographic paper, so the effect of the slit would have not worked.
I don't think it's going to work.
After attaching the lens to the body, I used a flush trim bit on the table router to make the opening on the body of the camera the same as the inside diameter of the lens. And later reprinted a new piece to hold the slit, which will bolt onto the same mounting holes as the lens. I also trimmed the rebate on the camera body on the table saw so the two pieces could fit together.
Another problem I have is because this section here was printed this way round, the compression of the filament made the groove that this section, this lip here, was meant to fit into just too narrow. Instead of trying to widen this, I think what I'm going to do is just do a few passes on the table saw and hopefully narrow that down. Okay, it fits together a bit better. One of the corners is not perfect, but I think if I was going to use this anyway, I'd put a seal of electrical tape around as well, just to make sure it doesn't pop out, because I don't actually have a locking mechanism for the lid.
A DIY camera is not complete without a lot of electrical tape. To find the focal length, I placed a piece of opal plastic where the photographic paper would sit and moved the lens until the object I was pointing at, in this case a light fitting, was in focus. I used a white pen to mark the lens and labelled the distance upon it.
Okay, so I've just marked four lines to indicate focal distance. The first one here is 20 centimeters, there's 25, 35 and 50. I can't seem to get a infinity focus with the lenses that I've used from the reading glasses. I think I need to do a bit of reading about how that all works. Left-handed scissors. I decided to make a smaller version of the camera, as the scale of the first model meant reprinting new parts just took too long. I also realised that I should try gear the disc so it would turn a lot slower. I did this by adding an annulus gear to the inside of the disc and connecting a smaller spur gear to the turning handle, which is now centred. I drew these up in Fusion 360 by hand, and the gear ratio is 100 to 17, so it takes roughly 5.9 turns of the handle to fully turn the disc.
I've just printed the box section of this. If we open it, it's still cooling, but the lip and the groove are a lot better suited. This one's wider here, this is a little bit narrower, and they fit together really nice, so I kind of worked that out. But to try and help avoid warping, which is a problem with 3D printed parts in PLA, it's come off the hotbed and I'm clamping it on to the lid so that hopefully that will keep the shape.
This development, alongside Silverprint, the place we normally get our photographic supplies from, having moved now outside of London, like everything else, this time to Poole of all places, means I'm only now just able to test the camera. And no offence to anyone from or around Poole, but if you are from or around Poole and you want to get into chemical based photography, well, you now have one of the best places on your doorstep.
Okay, this is a little area you don't get to see that often. It's the dark room. It's squeezed between two walls and a supporting arch in the building that we're based. It's a really unusual base. I've got the camera here, I'm going to do my first test.
Because of the sensitivity of the photographic paper, I'm loading it into the camera in the darkroom. If I were using negatives, I would have to do this in complete darkness, but photographic paper is a bit more forgiving. The paper is also negative, so the image will have to be inverted or made positive to see detail more clearly.
Okay, I'm using a bit of electrical tape as a shutter. I don't know what I'm going to record yet.
Yeah, I don't do clockwise or anti-clockwise.
Okay, here goes.
Cool. Oh, was the developer on the right?
The developer is closest to the door.
Okay. Oh, something doesn't look right. Alright, I forgot to put the slit in the camera.
Oh, shit.
That's still kind of cool though. Just got this kind of moon shape. Okay, let's do this again.
You can see I've actually got the slit on there now.
That was really stupid.
Nathan is building a belt-driven turntable to rotate a large object while taking a slit scan. He sat down on it to see if it could take his weight. I'm concentrating on turning the disc as slowly as possible. That's my concentration phase.
Even though the workshop feels quite bright, it will not compare to daylight. And I also have to factor in the speed I turn the disc, which exposes the paper, and the thickness of the slit, which acts like an aperture. In reality, you just have to do a few tests and compensate the next time around. On the negative paper, everything is reversed, so where I may have paused turning the disc or pointed at a light source, you can see dark lines, which means they were exposed or overexposed, and the light patches of paper, once inverted, will be dark, which means they were underexposed. So yet another video has come to a natural end. In the next video, I'm going to consider planetary gears to further reduce the rotational speed of the disc and continue developing the Slit-Scan disc camera. If you want to support this channel, you can sacrifice your thumbs to the algorithm gods or support me on Patreon, where I provide additional material to relevant videos. Thanks again for watching.